take. Hurry, Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
So now let's talk about a couple of situations. I think we were talking a little bit about it beforehand, involving kind of what happens at the accident. So first, you've got I have a lot of seniors, you know, who are very nervous that it's going to get blamed on me just because I'm an old person, and people are going to look askance on the fact that I'm an older person that's driving a car.
Right.
What is your sense of that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I can understand a person being nervous, but I think that, I think the most important thing is just to remain calm. And I think memorialize what happened as quickly as you can. I think, you know, addressing the immediate needs of if there's any bodily injury is critical.
And memorialize it. So get everything in writing.
You got it.
Get the story told.
Go home and spend 5 or 10 minutes before you call your insurance company and just write down your thoughts. What happened? Where were you? Because the questions that will be asked are, where were you? The obvious ones. What time was it? But more importantly, what happened? And I think it's important to really do a nice job of really giving some detail on what happened. And for two reasons. One, the primary reason is obviously so that if you're not at fault, they don't find you at fault. Right. And two, if there is a question of whether you're at fault and there is a surcharge involved, there's an appeal process in which you can appeal that surcharge. That happens probably 6 months after the accident because that's a registry of motor vehicle function.
Yep.
But it's important to have those notes because if you're, again, asked 6 months down the road,
what happened,
you want to be able to refer to the notes. And, you know, as you know, being in the legal profession, you know, there are certain circumstances in which a lawsuit is involved. And so you may be required many months down the road to remember what happened. So I think it's important to just keep really good notes.
And I suppose consistent with that would be when you're doing that report that you're filing someplace, keep yourself a copy.
We always give people a copy because I agree with you. Have a file on it. I think it's important to have a file on what happened. Also, you know, you can't overlook this, is if your car is in an accident and it does sustain damage, now they have Carfax and things of that nature. So when you go to possibly sell that car down the road, they're going to be able to look that up. But you may be able to provide them a little greater detail on, okay, we had an accident, but this is really what happened and this is what was repaired.
What's Carfax?
Carfax is a kind of an online venue in which they can look to see if your car has ever been in an accident.
A buyer can look to find if this car has been into it?
Correct. I'm not overly familiar with it, but you obviously see it advertised all the time.
Yeah.
And there is what we call diminution in value. A vehicle that's involved in an accident can depreciate a little bit quicker, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Than a vehicle that has not. But if it's done properly, and the body shops are excellent, they really, I mean, really, your car is brand new. And so you want to keep that information so that you can say, the car was involved in an accident, but, you know, ABC company did this, this, and this, and really the car is not any different than when it came off the factory floor.
Right.
Okay.
Right. I was unaware of that.
Yeah, so I think it's important.
I don't watch enough TV.
Yeah, right.
I'm not on the internet enough.
But I think it's important because that could have a financial impact on you down the road.
Yep.
So any time you can keep that information, I think, is important, and just have a file on it.
So now I'm going to talk about another a difficult case. So you get hit, right, by, it's like your worst fear, by the young, relatively uninsured person, maybe even totally uninsured, but more likely a young person who really does not have a lot of money and therefore has not bought a lot of coverage.
Right.
And now you're concerned about, in terms of the motor vehicle and more especially if you've been hurt at all,
right?
How can you possibly get compensated? Because this person's got this minimal policy. By the way, tell me, what's the lowest amount of coverage that you can have? For personal injury,
if I'm
insuring myself against the possibility of somebody claiming against me because I caused an accident.
Sure, $20,000 is the state minimum.
$20,000,
right?
So I can actually be on the road driving and have only $20,000 worth of coverage, protecting somebody else in the event that I hurt them.
That's correct.
Or damage
them.
That's
correct.
So from the perspective of my client, the older person, right, who is concerned about this stuff, right? Am I just exposed in that case, or is there anything that I can do?
Well, I think you raise an excellent point. I don't know that it's specific to your age. I think that any time you're involved in an accident, and there could be bodily injury, for example, the financial consequences are significant. And so that's why I think it's important to really appreciate and understand it. And one of the arguments I hear all the time is, well, I don't have anything, so why should I buy a lot of coverage? Well, that may be true today. Down the road, you may have something, so there could be what they call garnishment of wages.
Right.
But it's also a personal responsibility. You know, we're all in this together, so to speak, and so I think that it's important. And what I try to do is flip the argument around. If you're saying you don't want to buy a lot because you don't have anything and you don't care, what about when you're involved with someone who doesn't have anything? You're going to feel the same way? And so you always want to try to frame the argument so people can appreciate the fact that, you know, there are consequences both for you and against you by not really understanding the decisions you may make relative to your insurance coverage.
So that's from the perspective of you're telling me as a person who might get into an accident where I'm at fault, I really want to have enough coverage, both to cover the person that I might hit or to cover a passenger who may be in the car.
Sure. Right? I tell people all the time, I say my wife is a wonderful person, but if God forbid someone runs me over while I'm out jogging, she has no choice probably but to sue. Right. And so, you know, it's not a question of, well, you know, there's these two happy people. Sometimes it's out of necessity.
It's out of necessity.
And so I think we all have to be cognizant of that. And we have to look at it both from the perspective of I can be sued, but also from the perspective of, you know, it probably makes sense to provide the right coverage. Because if you were on the other side of that, would you want to make sure the person had the right coverage? And I think what people misunderstand is that auto insurance, although it's part of their budget, I get that, if it's really done correctly, doesn't have to be that expensive. And I think that, you know, the difference, because you got to remember the probability of a $0 claim to $20,000 is much greater than from $20,000 to $300,000. So the rate provides for that. So if your baseline at $20,000 is $400 a year, you may be able to increase from $20,000 to $300,000 or $250,000 for another $200 a year.
Which people don't appreciate.
I think they need to really understand that. They really need to sit down with a professional insurance person to appreciate that.
I often suggest to clients and say, you'll be amazed if you're, from the perspective of my clients who are typically older and have accumulated assets, so they're concerned about this possibility of a large liability claim. I always tell them, you know, if you're concerned, but you're concerned about your premium also, talk to your agent. You'll be amazed that by increasing your coverage to $1 million, but increasing your deductible by a certain amount, you may even end up with your premium going down because it's cheaper to insure that upper piece. And from my client's perspective, that's what they're trying to protect. They can deal with a $20,000 claim. It's the $1 million claim that they're concerned
Absolutely.
About.
Don't risk a lot for a little is the basic, you know, kind of premise of insurance. And I always tell people say to me, one of the other kind of misunderstood things is, you know, I drive a $10,000 car. It's not really worth a lot. Well, effectively, it's a $200,000 or $300,000 car if you're involved in an at-fault accident, and now the person that you've hit has to come back and sue you.
And sue you. But now I want to go back to that earlier case too. So suppose I'm the elder, and I'm kind of on the receiving end of this. That I'm involved in an accident. There's a young person who's really has very little insurance, and they're clearly at fault, But not much I can do because they only have a little bit of insurance,
right?
So is there anything that I can do ahead of time to insure myself against that risk that I may be involved in an accident where somebody else is at fault, but where I've really sustained significant damages? Can I insure myself against that?
Yes, you can. There's a component of the auto policy that allows you to buy increased limits. One of the compulsory coverages is to provide coverage for people who don't have enough insurance.
I see. To provide coverage for yourself.
So you can, correct. You can increase the limits under both the compulsory section. The compulsory section you can, I'm sorry. But you can increase the limits under the optional section in which you can hedge against a certain circumstance in which you're involved with someone who either A, doesn't have any insurance, or B, has very low limits.